My guest today was born in Richmond. 50 years later, he returned as chairman of the English RFU. In between, he has had an incredible career. He spent 10 years in the corporate world with the likes of PwC, Goldman Sachs, and the London Stock Exchange, but then 30 years as a technology entrepreneur. I'd like to say a very warm welcome to Tom Ilube. Tom, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you for inviting me.
Tom, you've done many incredible things, but you like to be known as the startup guy. Why?
I like to be known as a startup guy, I suppose, because I think of an idea and try and bring it to life. And it's that act of creation, turning a concept or an idea into something real and interesting, that startup step that I find most exciting and rewarding.
I love the fact that you started a trouser business at university. I started my shirt business at university. I thought I was the only idiot to be doing it, but I'm glad that you, who's gone on to do amazing things, started a trouser business. What happened to it? Why aren't you still doing trousers?
It was a way to earn some money when I was at university. I was at university in Nigeria, University of Benin, and back then people used to have their trousers sewn. So you'd go and buy material, you'd find a tailor, you'd get your trousers sewn. Everyone did that. And I realized that we could buy large amounts of material, hire several tailors, and we'd make trousers and sell them around the campus. And that's what we did.
Why did you stop? You could have been the trouser king.
I was a physicist and a mathematician, and that was more my domain.
Having been a startup, well, the startup guy and an entrepreneur for 30 years, what is it that makes a successful business for you, or a successful entrepreneur?
A successful entrepreneur, I would say it's a combination of persistence. You have a way of just keeping going, and entrepreneurs who just come back again and again and find a way, doesn't necessarily mean they keep doing the same thing, but they adjust and go again and again. That's at the heart of it. But I think it's also this desire to have an idea, and a lot of people have ideas and then they just reflect on them. Entrepreneurs have ideas and then want to see it in the world, and that I think is at the heart of being an entrepreneur.
It's interesting, I always found it interesting when there are serial entrepreneurs like you who started a business and another business and another business. If you want to see something, well, why don't you stick with one? Why do you keep starting a new one?
Yeah, I think I realized early on that there isn't really a single definition of an entrepreneur, a single way to be an entrepreneur. So there are entrepreneurs who have one idea and they grow it and that's what they do. There are entrepreneurs who have multiple ideas and put them into the world and keep creating. And I used to think one was the right way and another was the wrong way. And then I realized actually it's just a choice. Which bit of the journey do I enjoy? Which bit of the journey do I add most value to? And for me, it's that starting with a blank sheet of paper, literally a blank sheet of paper, and bringing a business to life. That's the bit that I really enjoy, and those early years of struggling to create something out of nothing and seeing it become something quite special. And then there are other people who are much better at me that then taking it and scaling it to something huge and amazing. And we're both entrepreneurs, but just different types of entrepreneurs.
Yeah. Of your many achievements, what are you most proud of?
It's creating my first company. I was at Goldman Sachs.
You're not counting the trousers.
No. I was at Goldman Sachs. I left that organization and I sat in a disused church hall that had been set up almost as a business center and sat there on my own with a flip chart and thought, I'm going to create something. And then I took the rest of the day off because I thought I'd done enough. And then seeing an actual company come out of that and people want to be employed by it and people investing money in it and customers buying things, just that process of having an idea and a blank sheet of paper and seeing a company emerge and thinking, gosh, that's how companies are created. Isn't that fascinating? That was very special.
Can you tell me a little bit about the African Gifted Foundation?
I set up the African Gifted Foundation about 10 years ago because what I was interested in was if you were a young African student, you know, you've literally got the brain power of an Einstein, but you happen to have been born in a village or a township somewhere. You know, how does that kind of get out into the world. And so I decided, let's create a foundation that looks for those young people and brings them together and gives them educational opportunities. And that eventually led to the creation of the African Science Academy, where we look for young women across Africa who have that exceptional academic gifted background and bring them into a school that takes them through an amazing program, and then off they go into the world.
So what does it cost to change a young girl's life?
£10,000. So where they're fully funded, they come to us for a year and they do maths, further maths, physics, A-levels in 12 months from start to finish. So almost all of them get A-stars, A's and B's, and everyone so far has ended up getting a scholarship, a full scholarship to a university all over Africa, all over the world.
It's amazing. And there are probably many, but is there one in particular where you are just so incredibly proud of what they've achieved and what they've gone on to do?
There was one girl who had finished secondary school and had been told by her family, that's it, there's no more money, so your education doesn't continue from there. And so she was helping out the family by, you know, selling oranges at the side of the road and so forth. And somebody said to her, there's this school, you were good at maths, you should apply. And she said, oh no, they say scholarships, they don't really give scholarships. No, they do. So she applied, her scores were off the chart. She came to us for that year. We had to convince her family that, you know, we were going to fund everything, she was going to come to us. I think she got 3 A stars in 12 months from a standing start.
Amazing.
And got a scholarship to Edinburgh University, 4 years to do engineering. And that will transform her life, and that will transform her family's life and the community around her. That's really special.
Absolutely incredible.
Yeah.
What do you consider to be the highlight of your philanthropic work to date?
At the end of each year at the Africa Science Academy, the students write to me, if they want to, about the impact that their time at the Africa Science Academy has had on them. When you read those letters and you realize the impact that you've had, it really moves me and it inspires me to do it again. So every year when I get that feedback, that is the highlight of my philanthropic work.
One of my favorite songs is Mr. Bojangles, Sammy Davis Jr. And I saw you've started your blog,
yes.
Mr. Bojangles.
Yes.
I think the last entry, the last time I was called a monkey was at work.
Mm-hmm.
And then I read that incredible story, incredibly powerful and incredible lessons. Can you just tell me what happened there?
What happened was I was involved in launching the internet bank Egg, as you mentioned, and I was one of the senior executives, and I happened to walk into a meeting room where at the end of the day, nobody was in there, and somebody had sketched a picture of a monkey on a flip chart and written Tom Ilube underneath it. And I took that away and I thought, wow, what do I do with that? Who was in that room? That's, you know, that's just, what do you do with something like that? The chief executive at the time heard about it and he said to me, Tom, let me tell you what I want to do. I want to get a corporate investigations firm to interview everyone in the company, and when we find out who did that, I'll fire them. There was a bit of my heart that thought, yeah, let's do that, but my head was saying, that's just not going to go down well. With all the hundreds of people who weren't involved, they'll still feel bad about the fact that they had to go through that process, and they'll think that I was the person that forced it on them. And so instead, what he did was he sent a very clear and unambiguous email to the whole staff, and he said, Tom went into a room, this is what he saw. I asked Tom if I could do this to find out who did it. He said no. So instead, what I'm saying to you who did that is your values are not our values and they're not the values of this organization. So I want you, whoever you are, to leave this organization. Someone once described it to me as they remember being there at the time. They said it felt almost like the day that the organization grew up.
Because that must have been Egg 20 years
20
ago?
20 years ago, yeah.
Do you feel like the country's grown up?
There are still issues, as we know, and things that need to be tackled and faced in different ways. But every generation, every half generation, things move forward. The things that my dad faced are different to the things that I faced. They're different to the things that younger people face. It's no use me saying to someone today who gets abused in some way, well, in my day, I was chased down the street or whatever. Mm. That's not good enough. It doesn't mean to them that it wasn't painful to them when somebody said the wrong thing to them. But overall, I feel that things are moving in the right direction.
What can we do to change, to make change happen a little bit faster?
It would be about being an ally, you know, listening to colleagues in whatever way they're different and learning from them, and not starting from a position or an opinion, but genuinely saying, tell me, let me listen to you, let me learn about the way you think about things, about the experiences in your life, and then thanking them at the end and saying, because then they feel heard and you will learn something that you can then use in a different situation.
Yeah. Tom, I have some quickfire questions for you.
Right.
Which country would you love to visit?
I would love to visit England in 100 years' time.
Will it be better?
Much better.
What book has had the most impact on you?
A book called Rosewater, which was an African science fiction book, because it brought together some really interesting ideas set in the future in a fascinating new way, an environment. And that sort of bringing together of different things always fascinates me.
What song most reminds you of your adolescence?
Ballroom Blitz by The Sweet.
Oh my God, we're almost the same age. You're a little bit older than me, actually, which I'm pleased by, because you've done so much more. I've got a lot of catching up to do, but I haven't even heard of the song. Tom, it has been an absolute pleasure. We've had, I think, the manager of the England rugby team. We've had the chief exec of the RFU, and you are by far the biggest and the best. We now have had the chair of the RFU. Tom Ilube, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.